Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Let's try that again. Good morning. All right, that's much better. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Society of Bangor here at 120 Park Street in Bangor, Maine. My name is Laurie Cartier, and I'm your worship associate for today. I'd like to welcome all of you who came out on this gorgeous Labor Day to be here in our sanctuary for an hour this morning, and all of you on Zoom as well. Hello, we've got quite a nice little crowd on Zoom. So if you are visiting us for the first time, know that you are so welcome. We hope that you will stay for our fellowship hour so that we can say hello to you and get to know you a little bit. And know that all are welcome here. So we're pleased to have a wonderful guest in the pulpit today, Sarah Nichols. I didn't tell her. Anyway, she's right down there. And Sarah is currently a UNISERV director at the Maine Education Association and the vice president of her union, the Maine Education Association staff organization. So, yay! Prior to her role as UNISERV director, she served for 6 years as a city councilor in Bangor, and she was first elected in November of 2015. She served as mayor in 2018. So I think you guys might remember her. If you are of Bangor, you would know. And she was the youngest mayor in the city's history. So there's more information about her, I believe, in the order of service. Okay, so we want to take some time each week to acknowledge that we live and worship on unceded Wabanaki land. We are grateful to be here and hope as a community to work to ensure that the Wabanaki people are granted the sovereignty they seek. Blessed be. Now, a few announcements. So Sunday, next Sunday, September the 10th, we have our annual water communion service with Reverend Drew back in the pulpit. Be sure that if you didn't already get water from your favorite place where that you may have traveled this summer to bring, go get some if it's close, or know that we always have a pitcher of water that can be your virtual ocean or water that wherever you went this year. So know that that's going to happen next week and be ready. It's usually a really wonderful opportunity for us to come together as community. Our first annual book sale is going to take place on September the 16th. So if you haven't already done so, now's the time to clean off your bookshelves and donate used books, CDs, and DVDs. They don't want cassettes. They don't want VHS tapes, sorry. Those are just too out of date, I guess. But then, after you've donated a whole bunch of stuff, you can come back on the 16th and buy books and replenish your shelves. So it's a fabulous opportunity for all of that.
Or tell all your friends.
Or just come and add to what you've already got, right? So our SEE classes will begin on September 17th. So if you have children that need to be registered, be sure to get that done. The SURE group will not be meeting today because we met on August the 20th. So we will have our first meeting of the church year on October the 1st. We will be working on many things, including helping make sure sovereignty is passed this year. So if you have any interest in joining our group, please do so. Shaw Ministry is going to meet on Tuesday in the Dorothy Memorial, I think at 6:30. And the Social Justice Committee is going to be doing a survey, and they are going to be doing that next week. And there is going to be one question, and that is, what is the most important social justice issue that you would like the church to be working on? So be ready for, I'm not sure how it will look, maybe just little pieces of paper that you write down your answer, but we will have that. I think they're going to have a box to put the answers in. So that's going to be very important to the Social Justice Committee. So be sure that you do that. I think that's it. Sorry? I can't hear you, Liam. Sorry.
Next social justice meeting. Do you know when that is?
The which meeting?
Social justice.
Usually they meet on the third Sunday, but there's some, a special Muson meeting happening, and they want to compile this information they're gathering about our social justice wants and needs. So they may be meeting next week or during the week. So I can't answer that for sure, but I would have thought the 17th would be their day to meet. Anything else? All right, so now sit back. Take a deep breath. Be ready to come into this space of worship. We have a real treat this morning of a musical piece that Linda Kaler wrote and accompanied by Rissa. And so we will just enjoy this music. Thank you. Thank you, Linda. So my computer, the picture is frozen. Is that happening everywhere, or it just must? Oh, there, it's moving a little bit. Okay, just want to be able to see what's on the screen. Okay, oh, thank you so much, Linda. That was beautiful. So we'll have Sue, Henry McKenzie, and hopefully Julian coming up to light the chalice. So there's words on your screen, Honoring Our Labors by Florence Kaplow, if you would say them along with me. In recognition of Labor Day, we light this flame to honor all work, including the work of our hands and our backs, in gratitude for all the labors that support our world and for all those who boldly continue the work of justice, equity, and peace. Thank you. Blessed be. Our opening hymn this morning is number 168, One More Step. We'll sing verses 1-4.
Peace for us and everyone. Take one more.
I'm having a problem that I don't have enough bandwidth on my computer, so I am hooking into my hotspot. So I hope you have a hotspot. It's pretty handy. So hopefully that will give me a much better... I'm still unstable. Should I go out and come back in, Atticus? I'm sorry, I'm going to try this because we need to be able to see my screen. So one more time. Yes. It is story for all ages. I apologize. I could have been messing with all this while she's doing the story for all ages. Thank you. I thought it would be a quicker thing. So Sarah is going to do our story for us this morning, and it will also be up on the screen. So anyone who is young or young at heart, please feel free to come forward to the rug, and we will hear the story of Brave Girl, Clara and the Shirtwaist Makers, strike of 1909.
Thank you for joining me up here. So yes, the story is Brave Girl, Clara and the Shirtwaist Maker Strike of 1909.
I didn't know you were around in 1909, Sarah.
I was not. And the book is by Michelle Markle. A steamship pulls into the harbor, carrying hundreds of immigrants and a surprise for New York City. Okay. The surprise is dirt poor, just 5 feet tall, and hardly speaks a word of English. Her name is Clara Lemlich. This girl's got grit, and she's going to prove it. Look out, New York. Clara knows in her bones what is right and what is wrong. What's wrong begins a few weeks after the Lemlichs move into their tenement in America. No one will hire Clara's father. They will, however, hire Clara. That's right, Clara. Companies are hiring thousands of immigrant girls to make blouses, coats, nightgowns, and other women's clothing. They earn only a few dollars a month, but it helps pay for food and rent. So instead of carrying books to school, many girls carry sewing machines to work. Clara becomes a garment worker. From dawn to dusk, she's locked up in a factory. Rows and rows of young women bend over their tables, stitching collars, sleeves, and cuffs as fast as they can. "Hurry up, hurry up," the bosses yell. "Rat-a-tat-tat," hisses Clara's machine. The sunless room is stuffy from all the bodies crammed inside. There are two filthy toilets, one sink, and three towels for the 300 girls to share. Clara learns the rules. If you're a few minutes late, you lose a half day's pay. If you prick your finger and bleed on the cloth, you're fined. If it happens a second time, you're fired. The doors are locked and you're inspected every night before you leave to be sure you haven't stolen anything from the factory. But Clara is uncrushable. She wants to read. She wants to learn. At the end of her shift, though her eyes hurt from straining in the gaslight and her back hurts from hunching over the sewing machine, she walks to the library. She fills her empty stomach with a single glass of milk and goes to school at night. When she gets home in the late evening, she sleeps only a few hours before rising again. As the weeks grind by, Clara makes friends with the other factory girls. At lunch, they share stories and secrets as if they were in school, where they belong. Clara smolders with anger, not just for herself, but for all the factory girls, working like slaves. This was not the America she imagined. The men at the factory tell her they've been trying to get the workers to team up in a union. Then they'd strike, refuse to work, until the bosses treat them better. But the men don't think the ladies are tough enough. Not tough enough? Because they're girls? Oh yes, they are. Clara knows it. She'll show them. From then on, at the sewing tables and on the street corners, Clara urges the girls to fight for their rights. When the seamstresses are overworked, she says, strike. When they're underpaid, she says, strike. When they're punished for speaking up, she cries, strike. And the girls do. Each time Clara leads a walkout, the bosses fire her. Each time she pickets, her life's in danger. The bosses hire men to beat her and the other strikers. The police arrest her 17 times. They break 6 of her ribs, but they can't break her spirit. It's shatterproof. Clara hides her bruises from her parents. A few days later, she's on the picket line again. And the other girls think, if she can do it, we can do it too. For weeks, the small strikes go on, but the bosses find other young women to do the work for the same low pay and long hours. We must do something bigger. Think Clara and her other union leaders. Something huge, a giant strike at every garment factory in the city. The union holds a meeting. Throngs of workers pack the seats, the aisles, the walls. The hall thrums with excitement. Clara listens to speech after speech. The speakers, mostly men, want everyone to be careful. 2 hours pass. No one recommends a general strike. Finally, the most powerful union leader in the country goes up to the podium. Not even he proposes action. So Clara does. That's right, Clara. She calls out from the front of the hall. The crowd lifts her to the stage where she shouts in Yiddish, I have no further patience for talk. I move that we go on a general strike. And she starts the largest walkout of women workers in US history. The next morning, New York City is stunned by the sight of thousands of young women streaming from the factories. One newspaper calls it an army. Others call it a revolt. It's a revolt of girls, for some are only 12 years old. And the rest are barely out of their teens. In the coming weeks, Clara is called a hero. She lights up chilly halls with her fiery pep talks. Her singing lifts the spirits of the picketers. When a group of thugs approaches, she yells, "Stand fast, girls." And they do. All winter long in the bitter cold, in their cheap, thin coats, tired and starving and scared, the girls walk alongside the men on the icy sidewalks of the picket line. They spill out of the union halls, blocking the roads, filling street corners and public squares. Newspapers write stories about them. College girls raise money for them. Rich women swathed in fur coats picket with the factory girls. By the time the strike is over, Hundreds of bosses agree to let their staff form unions. They shorten the work week and raise salaries. The strike emboldens thousands of women to walk out of garment factories in Philadelphia and Chicago. And the strike convinces Clara to keep fighting for the rights of workers. Her throat is hoarse, her feet are sore, but she has helped thousands of people, proving that in America, wrongs can be righted, warriors can wear skirts and blouses, and the bravest hearts may beat in girls only 5 feet tall. Yeah.
So this is the time in our service when we share generously with our community and our church as we pass the plate for the offering. Rissa will be playing Berceuse, is that how you say it? Berceuse by B.J. Roscoe as our offertory music. And then we finish that with number 402 from You I Receive. Thank you so much for your generosity. I didn't say it when I introduced this, but our share the plate this morning is with, and for the month of September, is with the Hemophilia Alliance of Maine, and one of our are they still members? I hope so. One of our members was one of the founders of that alliance as her boys went through some real severe illness. Okay. So our reading this morning, can you hear me all okay? I know maybe if I back up a little bit and you turn me up, Zoom was saying they need me closer, but the peas make such popping noises. Is that better on Zoom? Maybe they'll say yes or no. I'm gonna just go ahead. So our reading this morning is an excerpt from an article in the January 30th, 2022 Washington Post, and it's entitled Public Education is Facing a Crisis of Epic Proportions. It's by Laura Meckler, and the section that I'm going to read is called A Hunt for Teachers and Bus Drivers. So this was during COVID, and I don't think anything's gotten any better since. Sarah will talk to us more about that. So here's what this article says. Schools short-staffed on a good day had little margin for error as the Omicron variant of the coronavirus swept over the country this winter and sidelined many teachers. With a severe shortage of substitutes, teachers had to cover other classes during their planning periods, pushing prep work into the evenings. San Francisco schools were so strapped that the superintendent returned to the classroom on 4 days this school year to cover middle school math and science classes. Classes were sometimes left unmonitored or combined with others into large groups of unglorified study halls. The pandemic made an already dire reality even more devastating, and Becky Pringle, president of the National Education Association, said, referring to the shortages. In 2016, there were 1.06 people hired for every job listing. That figure has steadily dropped. It's reached, at this time of the article, it was reaching 0.59 hires for every opening last year. The Bureau of Labor Statistics data show this as a fact. In 2013, there were 557,320 substitute teachers, the BLS reported. And in 2020, the number had fallen almost 150,000 to 215,510. Virtually every district across the country cites a need for more subs. It's led to burnout as teachers try to fill in the gaps. The overall feelings of teachers right now are ones of just being exhausted, beaten down, and defeated, and just out of gas. Expectations have been piled on educators even before the pandemic, but nothing is ever removed, said Jennifer Schlicht, a high school teacher in Kansas, outside Kansas City. Research shows the gaps in the number of available educators are most acute in areas including special education and educators who teach English language learners, as well as substitutes. And all school year, districts have been short on bus drivers who have been doubling up routes and forcing late school starts and sometimes cancellations for lack of transportation. Many educators predict that fed-up teachers will probably quit, exacerbating the problem. They say political attacks add to the burnouts. Teachers are under scrutiny over lesson plans, and critics have gone after teachers' unions, which for much of the pandemic demanded remote learning. We just created an environment that people don't want to be part of anymore, said Daniel Dominic, executive director of AASA, the School Superintendents Association. People want to take care of kids, not to be accused and punished and criticized. So as we contemplate this information, that's the end of my reading. So as we contemplate this information, let's turn our attention to Pat Moulton as she sings the song Joe Hill, which was originally written as a poem by Alfred Hayes, and it was composed into music by Earl Robinson in 1936.
Joe Hill was a labor activist and organizer, born in the latter years of the 19th century and only lived to be 30 some years before he was executed for his advocacy of labor. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, says he. I never died, says he. The copper bosses killed you, Joe. They shot you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe. I didn't die, says Joe. I didn't die. And standing there as big as life and smiling with his eyes, says Joe, what they could never kill went on to organize, went on to organize. From San Diego up to Maine, in every mine and mill where workers strike and organize, it's there you'll find Joe Hill. It's there you'll find Joe Hill. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and I, says Joe, says I. You're 10 years dead, but Joe says I never died. But Joe says I never died. Rissa Moore.
Thank you. Thank you both so much. That was great. So now we've had part of the past, and I am inviting Sarah to come on up, and she will be speaking to us about how the labor shortage is affecting education in Maine.
Oh, okay. I'm just moving. Yeah. Okay. Thank you all for having me. I appreciate the time to speak on this. And I hear some sound reverberating, so waiting a minute. Oh, okay.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Remember to do that. Are the slides that?
I think you're fine.
Okay. I'm going to pull up my slides so I know where I'm talking from. Oh, there we go. So I recently, as you heard, graduated from Clark University in Worcester, and part of my thesis was analyzing further what I was seeing in the field in my job, which was essentially a UNISERV director, essentially as a union rep. So I work with educators from RSU 19 in Newport area all the way up to Jackman. I have all of Somerset County. So this is in relation to that work, and then kind of expanding on if to see if trends that we learned about 20 years ago were still in effect, essentially. Next slide. So in Maine, one of every six teachers over the age of 60, and the graduating rate of teachers coming into the state of Maine, is falling short of future need. Currently, UMaine has been seeing a large downturn in the number of students attending post-secondary education institutions, and they serve as the primary schools that funnel new educators into Maine public schools. Additionally, educators are becoming burnt out sooner and leaving the profession within the first 5 years of teaching, and these two converging issues are starting to cause a teacher shortage as older educators begin to retire. To complicate matters more, the stress of education The field took during the pandemic has caused many teachers to take on a larger burden in order to meet the educational goals of their school district and the state. And this burden has caused some to retire early or leave the profession entirely. Unfortunately, Maine needs to move quickly to address the needs of our growing diverse student populations in order to ensure that our workforce does not fall short of the state's future needs. And without increasing the number of teachers and support staff going into the profession and staying in the profession, this need may go unmet. Next slide. So in Maine and across the US, as you heard, the educator shortage has been feared for many years and is starting to be realized. In multiple Maine school districts, most noticeably some of Maine's larger school districts, Portland Public Schools and SAD 49, which is in Fairfield, has faced dire shortages due to lack of educational support staff. In Maine, these are called educational technicians. And ed techs provide one-on-one support for students that range from instructional support to functional skill support, which can include toileting and other tasks. So very difficult work. In Portland last year, they saw there was a shortage of 30 ed techs for their special ed program. And that group of technicians served approximately 1/6 of their student population. That reality caused Portland School Board to start looking if whether or not they should shorten the school week for special ed kids. If the district, honestly, if they were going to look to shorten the school week, that would mean students with individualized education plans would not have their educational needs met and begin to have unequal access to public education, which is not something we want. Similar in SAD 49, this is a district I work directly with. The district has faced vacancy rates last year between 20 and 38 ed techs. Currently, they're, as of last year, they were short at about 29 or 33% of their entire staff, ed tech staff. This extreme shortage of ed techs led to programs being reduced, causing special ed students to have half days when staffing levels were too low due to illness of staff or other reasons. And then the entire program got shut down for multiple days, causing students to remain home. Again, the shortage has created a situation where students' equal access to public education has not been met. Next slide. So in my research through my thesis, I reviewed articles that covered a variety of different perspectives and articles that discuss the aging demographics of changes in Maine, the characteristics of public school teachers nationwide, barriers to post-secondary ed, and the overview of the current condition of Maine's public education system, and then also articles regarding Maine teacher turnover and staffing issues. The articles came from various sources, Maine policy journals, policy papers by the UMaine system and the Maine Department of Ed, and then I also looked at data with the U.S. Department of Ed. Apart from one article, all the articles were written by Maine authors or institutions. My research for this thesis had three goals or pillars, as I like to call them, which was the effects and needs of an aging population in Maine, the current educator workforce and the issues around that, and then how to encourage or what is preventing people from entering the education field. Next slide. So things I learned through this research was that, as you know, Maine is getting much older. I reviewed articles from the Maine Policy Review that discussed this issue at length. They came from different points of view, but one article is primarily concerned about getting more older people into the workforce and providing more availability for higher education opportunities, while the other article seemed to focus more on demographic transformation and the impact of an aging population and how the great strain on the community and the state. What was interesting is that both were working from similar statistics, both stated in their own words how Maine is one of the fastest aging states in the U.S. and by 2030 Maine would have 26.5% of its population over the age of 65. Another primary issue of my research was the issues facing the current educator workforce. All the studies I found did primarily focus on teachers and administrators and did not focus on the support staff that keep public schools functioning. That obviously is a significant gap, and if we're looking to solve that problem. And moving beyond that, what was found in this research was Maine public education and teachers was pretty informative across multiple articles, even though they were published a decade apart, were quite consistent. It was not surprising that anyone who works in this field, like I do, and I know there are some other educators in the room, but it was noted that most of them in 2011 and all the way through 2016 were close to retirement age. That's more than a decade ago, with the average age back then being in the mid-40s. Additionally, Maine is one of the lowest average teacher salaries in the nation. It's about in 2011, ranking 43rd and the lowest in New England. And not much has changed in that arena. What's also interesting, because Maine is so rural, we find that higher poverty schools, which are generally in the more rural areas, typically do have lower teacher salaries in a lower salary state, and tend to primarily employ new teachers that are under the age of 25. And then the lower poverty schools, ones like Falmouth, wealthy areas of the state, are employing educators that are 26 years and older, which leaves a gap in mentorship and keeping teachers employed if they don't have that more experienced educator with them to help guide them through their first few years. So what was clear was that salary was a big part, because this is hard work, as you know, and the salaries are lower than what it costs to live in Maine. And so the research definitely showed that salary was one of the biggest factors, and that is something that Maine definitely lags on. The third pillar of my research was identifying barriers to going into post-secondary education. And some of the research was assumptions that I had that actually was in line with the research. Some of the contributing factors of why we're not seeing more younger individuals going into the field was because we're a net exporter of students. Most of you probably have kids that probably went to out-of-state schools. They probably didn't end up at UMaine if they did go on to post-secondary ed. And then they may stay there. Most people that go to school in another stay within that area after school. And so it makes it harder for them to go into education in Maine. most of the rates regarding regions that had the lowest rates of post-secondary education were tied to where there was, in the past, strong mill communities or strong fishing communities. So most of the parents may not have gone to school and have guided them into that family business. And so not having that parental support in that way, because they may not have gone to college themselves, have a harder time guiding someone to post-secondary ed if that wasn't their own experience. So all of this has led to a smaller pool of students exiting post-secondary education in Maine with the goal of becoming an educator here. Next slide. So like I talked about, salary and benefits were the primary driver of whether an individual pursues a career in education. So when I looked to try to see how that's affecting the research effects current day, I looked at the salaries for educators all throughout Maine in 22 and last school year, essentially. And so I looked at teachers with bachelor's degrees, what the average was, teachers with master's, EdTech 1s, EdTech 2s, and EdTech 3s. They all do have different classifications I won't go into right now. But the goal of analyzing that data was to see, one, are salaries keeping up with inflation? They're not. Are there consistent patterns with the data that demonstrates an understanding if there are salary disparities that are greater than the cost of living variances? And if there are trends between less populous counties and more populous counties, and if there are outliers? Additionally, I wanted to review some data that the MEA collected early last year to see what were the top issues and concerns, and if that kind of educators currently, and if that kind of went on track to the things that we were learning about 10 years ago. And the goal was to see, is like I said, if these trends continued and if those new issues have evolved, or that they would demonstrate to educational leaders that there's still issues, or do we need to pivot in order to keep classrooms supplied with quality educators? Next slide. So the top three issues that MEA members had last year, most of them that answered were K through 12 educators, were instructional and classroom strategies, family and community engagement, and social and racial justice. And the top two are important because if you're a newer teacher, those are the things that you learn as you're evolving in your job, why it's important to have mentors and that I talked about earlier and have those supports. And so if there are educators struggling with these core things of their job, that means, I mean, we need supports. They're obviously qualified, they've met the qualifications of the state, but in order for them to not get burnt out, these are clearly things that they need. And so it's showing that, to me, there is a large number of retirees or people retiring and leaving, and whoever is coming in are not having those supports there to keep them in the classroom for a long period of time, hopefully for the rest of their career. Next slide. And so just out, I'm not going to go through everyone, but with teachers with bachelor's degrees, if with their entire career, the highest shouldn't be a shock. It's in York County, southern part of Maine. Most teachers there are start at $43,455, so right out of school. And then the max, which could be 30, 40 years from this, or 20 years from the start of their career year to that point, is 71,000, just almost 72. And in Franklin County is the lowest in the state, where all but one actually school district in this county start at 40,000, which is the state minimum. And the max is similar to the max in York, but again, looking, you have to look at different scales, which I won't get into right now, could mean a longer period of time to get to that top, which means lower career or higher career earnings over the course of your career. Next slide. And then for ed techs, Sagadahoc, it may not be a populous county, but it is a wealthy county. Ed tech ones, which is minimum when they start, make 16 an hour there. In Washington County, the lowest, they make minimum wage. And the ed tech ones are generally the ones that are doing a lot of that direct, more honestly, when I was talking about toileting and other care, that's usually the work that they're ended up doing, and the direct instruction. The EdTech 3s can do, they, in Sagadahoc, the highest is $21.29, and an EdTech 3 in Washington County starts off at $15.29. People who are providing direct education to students. So not high, it's not enough to live, especially in Washington County, and but they're providing our education. So we want to make sure that they're well compensated for this high level of work. Next slide. So this is, again, just a big overview what the average is in Maine for teachers at different levels. So if you have a master's degree, which most do, they do end up a little higher by the end of their career. Next slide. And then again, for ed techs throughout the state, just for information. Next slide. So how can we help our public education workers? Because as you know, public education is highly labor intensive, and what happens with them directly impacts our students. And so supporting them supports our students. And so what can we do to make sure that this path doesn't continue? Next slide. First is to advocate, and knowing on what to advocate for. And I think that's the key thing. Right now, there are a few bills in the legislature that are still going into the spring session. They are to raise wages for teachers up to $50,000 starting, and for educational support staff, I think the bill currently, it could be tweaked, but it's at 150% of the minimum wage, so it would be constantly tied to that. And so this includes custodians, ed techs, bus drivers, all of which that do support a school to keep them running. And so this is incredibly important, because especially with ed techs, they can get, they're not paid year round. They're not paid for July and August. And so, and they do not qualify for unemployment because they have a promise of work in September. This is the same for any hourly employee in a school. And so making low wages and then also not working for 2 months makes it harder to stay in this field. And we need quality support staff in order to support the teachers that are also doing the direct instruction. It's also important to continue, there's this new program the Maine Department of Ed started, which is directly in line with the research I did with Clark. Not, they didn't take my advice, but it is in line. They started an educational technician facilitator program and teacher residency program to kind of, it's not so much lowering the bar, but it is making it more accessible for people to join and become educators without all the barriers that currently are there for some. And so trying to get more quality educators in the classroom and quicker. Right now, there's no permanent funding. It's funded year to year. This is only in the second year. So it's important to advocate for permanent funding for this program because we are seeing significant positive impacts of this program. And finally, you should advocate for local and state funding. Right now, we are lucky that the state is finally funding its 55% mandate for public schools, but it still means 45% of public schools is funded by your local communities. And that's still a very large share, and that can lead to inequities across the state. And so we want to ensure that advocating at all of your town levels, no matter where you live, that we have quality education for every student and not just those that can afford it. Next slide. Write. This is really important. Write to your legislators about the bills I just talked about. They need to hear, they really needed to hear it this past fall when they decided to carry it over instead. I think they know it's important, but they're not hearing enough from people in the community, enough, not even enough from educators, because they're burnt out, to be honest, from just trying to do their jobs. So it's important that these bills are talked about with your legislators. Write to your local school board. This is also important because they do go in front of the legislature a lot or talk about some of these issues. And so some of them are directly related to local issues, some of them are state issues. And so showing to your community leaders that this is important to you will help them advocate, or either at the local level or at the state level. Write a letter to the editor. Tell all your friends, tell the public about these bills and about these issues. Most people still are unaware about the crises that are happening in public schools, and this is important to make sure it's more broadly known. And writing and your public educators and tell them that they're important. Tell them, even if you don't have students in school anymore, it's important for them to know that the community has their backs, because in many communities, even around Bangor, they're being attacked constantly. And it's important to, we don't want them to leave because they think there's no support in the community. We want them to stay, we need them. And it's important that they know that the community has their back. And I should also note, and for some reason I didn't make this into a slide, if you're able to substitute teach, you should sign up to substitute teach. That would also go a very long way to helping educators. Next slide. Show solidarity. That's always a very good labor thing. We had school staff recently in Milford on the picket lines, fighting for higher wages and better working conditions. Showing up for your local associations, local teachers, when they're on the picket lines, when they're fighting for contracts, standing with them is really important. Reaching out to your local association president and letting them know that you're ready to be there if they need your help. Sometimes it's not right away, but sometimes it's helpful if it's not just the teachers standing up for themselves. They do need people behind them to ensure, to show to the people that they're advocating for that it's not just them, it's everybody that cares about this issue. And volunteer at your local union hall. Obviously, we have one right over there in Brewer, and they do a lot of good to help with a lot of different labor issues, but they do, especially every year, do something that help educators directly, and I think it's important to get involved with them. Next slide. And finally, If you're like me and get fed up with this, you can run for office. It is actually way more achievable than one would think. So nothing is more important than serving on a local board, in my opinion. This is where pavement meets the road and where real and direct change can happen. And having strong pro-education members on school boards is incredibly important when it comes to securing positive working conditions and pay for staff, and maintaining and recruiting quality staff for your local public schools. Most school boards also aren't competitive. Bangor might be one of the few places, but most places people are running unopposed. So it's really good to oppose them and actually make it competitive to get those voices on their school board. Next slide. So finally, it's up to all of you to ensure that we have quality public schools. The teachers and the educators there cannot do it alone. They're struggling, they're short-staffed, they're tired. They need all of us to ensure that they can do what they do to ensure that our community has well-educated children that go into the community in the future and help keep this positive track going. We want to ensure that everyone has equal opportunity for success, and it's up to all of us to ensure that our education system thrives. So thank you. I'll stay here. I'll get you the bill numbers. I don't have them right here, but
stay right here.
You.
Oh. They were looking at your slides, so I just wanted to give you a chance to wave.
Hi.
Say hi.
Hi.
So if you're a part of the MEA, be sure that you get in touch with Sarah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
really
for having me.
Appreciate it. Absolutely. Woo.
I think I'm back. Am I back?
Yeah.
Hopefully everyone can hear me. So thank you so much, Sarah, for being with us and for helping us understand a little bit more about the issues in the education in Maine. And I hope that some of us can go out and see how we can make a difference. All right. So. And for closing words this morning, I want to go back to the article that I read, which was probably a little too long for today's reading, but this is very short. And it's just a paragraph towards the end that just gives me a little hope. It says, some high-profile boosters of public education are optimistic that schools can move past this moment. Education Secretary Miguel Cardona last week promised it would get better. And Randy Weingarten, president of the American Federation of Teachers, said if we can rebuild community education relations, if we can rebuild trust, public education will not only survive, but has a real chance to thrive. So let's hope for that in Maine. So did you want to extinguish the chalice, Julian or Sue? As we extinguish our chalice this morning today, let us be ever mindful of the need for all of us to advocate for and work towards solutions to the education crisis. Let us take the message out into our world and allow the solutions to ripple forth until everyone understands and takes action for public schools and the best possible education for our beloved children. Blessed be. Because we're running late, I skipped the final hymn. If you really want to sing it, we can, or we can just go straight into the benediction. What do you think? Do the benediction and go to fellowship? Everybody giving me a thumbs up? Okay, that's what we'll do. So here's the words on the screen. Do you need them to play the, are you playing it on the piano? Oh yeah, cool. All of our musicians used to not be able to play it and now they can. Let's join hands. Let's form a circle-ish. And let's go through with our benediction and then go to fellowship hour. Thank you.